their joys of being, of aging and being retired is that every now and again you can have an opportunity to introduce a former PhD student giving a distinguished lecture. And this is the situation today. I'm very pleased to have here Kostya Avdachenkov, who is director of research at the well-known INRIA Institute in France, in Sofia, in Antipolis. He is also a graduate. His first degree was a master's degree with honors from the St. Petersburg State Polytechnic University in Russia, followed by a PhD degree in mathematics from University of South Australia, followed by a habilitation degree, that's a Doctor of Science degree in computer science from University of Nice. He has very diverse research interests covering Markov chains and Markov decision processes, theory of singular and analytic perturbations, machine learning, queuing theory, game theory, communication systems, and complex networks. He's already produced 13 PhD students, and I expect that that number will grow because he's a gifted supervisor as well. So I'll turn it over to Kostya. And we would like that you save your questions for the end of the lecture. And just ask them at that time. Okay.
Thank you very much, Jerzy, for your very kind introduction. And also, I would like to thank AMSI and Zian for giving me opportunity to present several lectures around Australia. This is particularly dear to me because I've done my PhD in Australia under the supervision of Jerzy and Phil Howlett. So let's start this lecture. And in this lecture, I'll try to speak about both aesthetics and numerous applications of Markov chains. So let's start this lecture with a small musical quiz. Can you guess without using your mobile what is this piece of music? A style of music. Well, yes. that was a good guess. But a style of music. Yes, good. So it's a dance music, right? And it's not a march, because march is a particular type of dance music. You're just supposed to know this one. No, but what type of music it is? Well, opera, yes. It's a dance in the opera. But what kind of dance it is? Okay, I will not torture you anymore. But it's Polonaise. So you know it's a traditional Polish dance. you should have guessed this one. And indeed, it's a piece from the opera Eugene Onegin. This opera was composed by Tchaikovsky and was inspired by Eugene Onegin. We'll see in a few moments that this poem, Eugene Onegin, has inspired not only music, but also some very beautiful mathematics. Okay, so the topic of today's lecture are Markov chains, and they were discovered by Andrei Markov. And that at least two versions about the origin of Markov chains. One version is philosophical, and another version is romantic. So let's start with the philosophical version. Consider a sequence of independent and identically distributed random variables xk, and consider their average up to the time moment n. So we have a discrete time, and each time we have an arrival of a new realization of the random variable x. So at time slot one, we have random variable x1, at time slot two, x2, etc. So we average them up to time n, and we assume that the variance of this random variable is finite. And since they're independent, we can write the variance of the average as the sum of variances, right? So because they're independent. And this gives us that the variance of the average is in fact inversely proportional to n. So as we increase n, the variance of xn bar gets smaller. Also noting by the linearity of the expectation, that the expectation of the empirical average is just equal to the expectation of x1, and applying the Chebyshev inequality. By the way, Chebyshev was the teacher of Markov. So we apply the Chebyshev inequality to the empirical average, and we get this inequality, which says that with the growth of n, it's very unlikely that the empirical average deviates far from the expectation of the random variable. So this is called the weak law of large numbers. Okay, in the beginning of 20th century, there was actually quite a big debate if the independence condition, which was crucial in the way the first weak law of large number was established, is a necessary condition. So many good mathematicians even believe that is a necessary condition for the weak law of large number, and some philosophers gave some philosophical justification for this. So already at that time, people were collecting statistics, a lot of statistics, and in particular statistics about crimes. So the statistics about crimes actually followed very well the law of large numbers. And philosophers argue that this is a manifestation of the free will. So free will, it's a practical side of independence, right? So we're independent of our background, and we decide if we commit crime or not, right? Whereas if we believe in predestination, so then we say that, well, because of my very bad past, I was just conditioned to commit this crime. And the philosophers and scientists at the beginning of 20th century argued that the weak law of large number is just manifestation that we are governed by free will and not by predestination. Okay, so that's a little bit what I said already. And if we have dependence between variables xk and xl, we cannot write anymore the variance as a sum, but there will be many other cross terms which are given by covariance. So you already see if we have like a strong predestination or strong correlation, we'll have n squared terms. N squared terms like this. So it will break at least the method of proving the weak law of large number. So at least that method. So what Markov demonstrated, he demonstrated that a fairly general case of dependent random variables can actually also lead to weak law of large number. And this fairly general case became later known as Markov chains. In fact, Markov already used term chain in his original 1906 paper. Of course, he didn't call them Markov. Yeah. Okay, so that was the philosophical origin of Markov chain. And now let me tell you about more romantic origin of Markov chains. So Markov was also very fond of this Russian poem, Eugene Onegin. And so you can appreciate that poem, let me give you a small extract of this.
Jana's letter to Onegin. I'm writing you this declaration. What more can I in candor say? It may be now your inclination to scorn me and to turn away. But if my hapless situation evokes some pity for my woe, you won't abandon me, I know. I first tried silence and evasion. Believe me, you would have never learned my secret shame had I discerned the slightest hope that on occasion, but once a week, I'd see your face, behold you at our country place, might hear you speak a friendly greeting, could say a word to you.
I hope now you get an idea why people were fond of this piece of poetry. So what Markov wanted to do, he wanted to study various statistics about the poem Eugene Onegin. And of course, the first statistics which come to our mind, let's count the number of vowels and consonants in the poem, right? So he just did that. According to intuition, which number should be bigger? Yeah, good. Actually, slightly bigger. So it's not that much bigger, but slightly bigger. Okay. So he counted 20,000 letters. Yes, letters of the Eugene Onegin poem. And he computed the empirical probability of appearing a vowel. So it's about 43%. And consonant, accordingly, about 56%. Okay. So what is the next step, right? The next step is to count the frequency of the pairs, say vowel, vowel. So he counted those, divided again by the total number of pairs, and obtain this empirical frequency. So then, if the vowels and consonants were independent, right? So the appearance of two vowels in a row would be given by PV square, right? If the letters would be independent. So your guess now, this number is smaller, bigger, or equal? Bigger than this? A lot? Okay, well, a lot, you know, we know that everything depends on the scale, right? It's bigger, yes, good guess. So in particular, but yes, three, again, you know, for somebody, three is bigger, well, that's the number of scale. The question of scale. What is important that, you know, it also says that there's a negative correlation, right? So if they have vowel, there's much less likely to have vowel than consonant. Yes, and Mark, I think Markov also tried this, and it was even, you know, for the language model, it was even better fit. So he actually, you know, it's amazing how Markov was ahead of his time. So of course he introduced Markov chain, but he introduced them directly on denumerable state space. So he has written, well, that's a side note for specialists. So instead of using finite transition matrix, he immediately introduced them for infinite transition matrix. And then he introduced also Dobrushin coefficient, which is used in statistical physics with various ergodic questions in statistical physics. Then he also introduced and passing hidden Markov chains, and all this in one paper. Well, quite impressive. And he didn't even use any theorem or lemma. So probably it was still the style of writing at that time. So he just says that this and that, and he concluded with the weak law of large number, but he didn't say that it's a theorem. Well, just a historical interlude. And of course, you know, now n-grams are still extensively used in various modern language models. Okay, let's now do some more exact mathematics and introduce Markov chains in more exact way. So we consider a state space S, and the state space could be either finite or infinite. And we consider a sequence of random variable xn with their values in S. And we call such a sequence a discrete time Markov process or Markov chain if the probability of a state at the next time step, given the complete history, is equal to the probability of that state given just the current step of the process. And if the right hand side is not dependent on time, we call this Markov chain homogeneous. So let us take an example 2x2. So for 2x2 example, we can use a total probability law and write that the probability of the Markov chain at the next step n plus one to be equal to is given by the probability of being at state one times the conditional probability of state two given state one, plus the probability of the process being in state two times the conditional probability of being in state two given state two. So this is just the total probability law. And this can be generalized to more than two states. And if we generalize to more than two states, we can write this in the matrix form. So we can write that pi n plus one, where pi n plus one is a row vector, is equal to pi n times matrix P, where matrix P is the matrix of conditional probabilities. And pi n plus one is the probability distribution for the Markov chain at state n plus one, and Pn, respectively, the probability of distribution of the Markov chain at step n. So that's a very convenient, as we know, matrix multiplications are often, matrix manipulations are often very convenient. So for example, for Pushkin chain, we have this. We have two states, one state associated with vowels and another state associated with consonants. And as you see, indeed, the transition from vowel to vowel has a quite small probability, right? And this is what we also saw just a few minutes ago. Okay, so just a couple of more technical definitions. So a Markov chain is called irreducible if from any state Sj, there is a path to any state, sorry, from any state Si, there is a path to any state Sj. A Markov chain is aperiodic if for any state Si and any state Sj, this probability is greater than zero for sufficiently large values of n. And then if a Markov chain is both irreducible and aperiodic, we call such a Markov chain ergodic. What are benefits of dealing with ergodic Markov chains? The benefit is that if we consider the initial distribution times the power of transition matrix, then in the limit, we converge to this so-called stationary distribution. So in the limit, we forget the effect of the initial conditions. And how can we obtain this stationary distribution? This stationary distribution is just a solution of the following linear system. So it's pi times p is equal pi plus the normalization condition. So it's the same here, but in element form. Next, consider an important subclass of Markov chain, which are called singularly perturbed Markov chain. And we can start considering this subclass with the following small but illuminating example. So we have just two states. And say the transition to itself in the first state is 1 minus epsilon. Transition to another state is epsilon. And the same for the second state. The transition to itself is 1 minus epsilon, and to back to state 1, epsilon. So we can see that for any epsilon strictly greater than zero, the chain is ergodic, is by symmetry, its stationary distribution is just 1/2, 1/2. However, if we take epsilon exactly to be equal zero, it is not ergodic. Once the chain started in, say, state 1, it will forever remain in this state, right? So because if epsilon is zero, the probability of moving out of state 1 to state 2 will be zero. So we'll get stuck in state 1. And the same for state 2. So we have, in fact, if epsilon is equal to zero, we'll have two invariant distributions, 1, 0, and 0, 1. Okay, so let us generalize a little bit more this example. So instead of just a block of two states, we'll have k blocks. And then we perturb this block structure by epsilon c. So epsilon c corresponds actually to slow transitions, right? So if the values in this block correspond the transitions of some given time scale, the transition epsilon c corresponds to rare transitions. So system spends a significant amount of time in one block before eventually moving to some other block, spending again a significant amount of time in that block. So this example is this mathematical example can describe many natural phenomena. For example, in meteorology, there are several natural time scales, like weather pattern, daily weather pattern, seasonal weather pattern, etc. Or as we saw in linguistics, right? It could be patterns of letters, patterns of words, or patterns of rhymes in a poem. So there's, as I already said, in the case of single perturbed Markov chain, the stationary distribution corresponding to the perturbation parameter zero is generally not equal to the limiting stationary distribution. So how do we find this limiting stationary distribution? In the interest of time, I will not spend some minutes on this, even though there's a very beautiful matrix analysis. So if somebody is interested, I can explain later, but I have more interesting things to tell, but this matrix analysis is very beautiful. So let me mention that the singularly perturbed Markov chains has a very long history, and probably this history started with the paper by Simon and Anda from 1961. And then a big number of researchers worked on singularly perturbed Markov chain, and the Australian School of Mathematics contributed significantly to this research direction, which such names as Eugene Sineta, Jerzy Filler, Moshe Haviv. So interestingly, there has been much less research on Markov chains, on single perturbed Markov chains with infinite state spaces. So in fact, you know, this for references may be about it. Maybe there are a couple of more references which I missed, but not so much. But, so that's one of the direction. If some of you wants to do research in Markov chains, I think this is a good direction of research. Okay, let us now speak a little bit about various applications of Markov chain. And since at INRIA, I work a lot with telecommunication companies, for me, the following is a very natural example. So let us consider a discrete time queue. So what it is, a job arrives with probability, the time is slotted. So each time a job arrives with probability P, and the job is served with probability Q. And say we have K waiting spaces, and the queue works in pi for mode. So first in, first out. So this model is actually can be given by the random walk on lattice. However, that's all good, and you know this model can be the previous model can be analyzed. Well, everything can be analyzed very nicely with many explicit formulas. However, in practice, this model is often not applicable. Why? Because we have busy hours and off-peak hours. How do we model this? We model this, for example, by the change in P and Q, and we can model it by two state Markov chain. So suppose we have the probability of arrival P on in a busy period remaining in with probability one minus epsilon alpha P, and switching to probability P off with probability epsilon alpha P. So again, here we see that epsilon should be small. And this means that the environment changes on a slow time scale. And in fact, if we consider a combined model, so the previous queuing model plus this model for the environment, the combined Markov model will become a singularly perturbed Markov chain. And it has been analyzed in a series of works. Then I want to mention another very interesting model, also about queuing. In the internet routers, packets arrive with a very high rate. And of course, internet routers also have not unlimited memory. So we have to sometimes decide what packets we discard. However, if we use the instantaneous queue length for this decision, we can discard unnecessary many packets. So suppose a burst of packets arrive. So if we make a decision, say, based on the threshold and the instantaneous queue length, we discuss the whole burst. But then maybe there's a period of time with no packets at all. And we can regret that we discard all packets from this burst. So therefore, it's much better to use to base a decision about discarding packets, not based on not on the instantaneous queue length, but on its average. So for example, the exponential moving average is given by this formula, where epsilon is some small parameter. So let us see that if epsilon is zero, the average is just stuck in one initial value. And if epsilon is not zero, then we have some slow evolution of the average value. So this is a very interesting example of single perturbed queuing system. And this example is actually very tricky. So its state space is very tricky. Okay, the queue is evolves, of course, on the discrete state space. But then the average queue, potentially, if epsilon say rational number, then the average queue potentially could take any rational number from the interval 0, 1. So yes, that's a very tricky state space. And in fact, thanks to discussion with Cecilia, it turns out that this example is related to so-called Bernoulli convolutions, which could even to fractal behavior. All right. As always, it's very surprising and very nice in mathematics that very simple formulation, very simple equations can actually lead to very sophisticated phenomena. Okay, so let us consider one more application. And this application is about search engine and web ranking. So a question to you, what is the best place to hide information on the web? Your guess. Or maybe you know this joke, yes? Well, very good. Yes, very good. I like this. Probably it's the second best place. I like this answer. Mm-hmm. Okay, again, I will not torture you. So it's page 2 of Google search results. So nobody, and me included, go to the second page of Google search results, right? So so the ranking of the results is extremely important. Of course, there are many criteria which Google uses to rank the results, but one of the criteria is based on random walk and Markov chains, random walk on graphs. So what they do, they consider web graph. By the way, this is probably the biggest application of the Markov chains. So the graph has about 10 to the power 10 web pages, so 10 to the power 10 nodes. And hyperlink between pages are just the links on the edges of the graph. So what we do, we consider a random walk on this graph and a simple random walk. So we choose the next node to visit just uniformly out of neighbor set. It's not that important. You can start anywhere. So there is a much bigger problem with this original model. So a much bigger problem is that graph may not be connected, and typically it is not. It has disconnected components. So to mitigate this issue, actually the creators of Google proposed the following perturbation of the model. So with, say, with probability alpha, we do this standard random walk, but with the complementary probability 1 minus alpha, we jump uniformly, right? So in this case, you can just say as well, we choose the initial point uniformly. Anyway, if alpha say 0.85, then on average after 6 steps, you restart from the uniform distribution. Yes, and it's 10 to the power 10. Yeah. Okay. So now let us make the following change of variable. Epsilon is equal to 1 minus alpha. And we are back in the framework of singular perturbation. And why singular perturbation? Because we have these blocks for the transition matrix, which correspond to the disconnected components of the web graph. And this uniform perturbation unites these disconnected components. So one interesting observation that this approach based on singular perturbation results in the following we can call it decomposition of page rank. So this perturbed mark random, the stationary distribution of the perturbed random walk is given in the following form. So pi tilde corresponds to the stationary distribution of the unperturbed model. If pi tilde corresponds to such stationary distribution for block one, and so on. And then we weight by the fraction of nodes in each block. So there are interesting conclusions from this. So one conclusion that is good to be popular, but it's even better to be popular in a large community, right? Because you multiply by the size of your community. So maybe I have a few moments to tell about one more application in reinforcement learning. One more application about reinforcement learning. So what is reinforcement learning? We have an agent and an environment. And agent generates actions. And from the environment, we have the change of state and some reward. So let us be specific with a small example. And we consider a mouse who is an agent in this case. We have a labyrinth, which is environment. And we have a reward, a piece of cheese. So the actual reward is very difficult in this example, right? The mouse gets the reward only if she successfully went through the labyrinth, right? So in fact, we give the reward say of one only when the mouse gets out of the labyrinth, and zero at any other steps. So that's a very difficult process to learn actually, right? In our common terms, it's like training your patience. And we know training patience is difficult. So what are the actions for mouse in this case? For example, if the mouse in this position, right, the mouse can go up, can go down, or can go left. So there are three actions in this state. So we want to train mouse to reach the piece of cheese as quickly as possible. And generally there are two types of rewards in the reinforcement learning models. So one reward is the discounted reward. So you discount in time. So if mouse learns too slowly, the cheese could be rotten or taken by another mouse, right? So we discount, if it comes too late, it has less value to us. Or we can have long run average reward. So we average the reward of all time intervals. So one of the most popular reinforcement learning algorithms for the discounted reward is so-called Q-learning, and it was proposed by Watkins in 1989. And basically, this is a stochastic approximation scheme for the solution of Bellman equation. This is a version for the discounted reward, and there's a version for the time average reward. The problem with the version for the time average reward is that it works only for ergodic Markov chains. So, of course, not all processes are ergodic, right? So what do we do if a process under consideration is not ergodic? So do we have any solution? Yes, and it's actually PageRank who gives us the solution. So what we can do, we can perturb a little bit the original transition. So instead of the original transitions P, we can have, like in PageRank, 1 minus epsilon times P plus epsilon, say, the uniform distribution. So we can also write the, now we can apply the reinforcement learning algorithm for the ergodic Markov chain. So hit it. And what is nice, we actually even don't need to sample from this uniform distribution. So like in some cases, the state space could be too large, or if it's a robotic application, it's not like we can always move instantaneously from one gesture to another gesture, right? So we can do this in a algebraic way. So we can combine this perturbation in an algebraic way with the random sampling of the original process. And finally, if we let this epsilon go to zero, we obtain most selective Blackwell optimal policy, which subsumes both the discounted and long run average optimal policies. So I think here I stop doing a little bit of selfish advertisement of my two books. One book is co-authored with Jerzy, and another book is a very recent book co-authored with my PhD student, Maximilian Dreveton. So I stop here, and now is the time for questions.
I think I know how to pass the microphone from person to person. I'm not sure if I know how to take questions from people connected by Zoom.
Mm. Let me see. By the way, if you have questions, please type in the chat. I'll try to retrieve the chat and answer the questions.
I'm going to let Ole finish his question. You see. Yes.
We go on. Is this on? Yes. So I was just curious again about the page ranking algorithm, because I thought that the advantage Google had, and of course there's debate now if they'll keep that advantage, is by essentially not telling the rest of the world what they're doing. But you seem to indicate that you know roughly, or at least you have a good idea what is.
I don't want to name, but at least some good competitors, I know what good competitors are doing, and they are also successful. So that, yeah, what I said, that they are not doing simple random walk, but you know, modified random walk, where you modify transition. So right, so suppose you have a web page and some links, and say you think that one links are more relevant to this page than the other, right? So you can give more probability to that link based on semantic similarity between the documents. So that's at least one successful competitor of Google is doing, I know.
Right.
And you know, there are other criteria. So again, this successive competitor, in addition to PageRank, has another 14 criteria, right? So there's a weighted criteria. In total, there are 15 criteria which they weight in order to rank the results. But modified PageRank is one of them.
So what surprises me a little bit, if you take a jump to, right, essentially using some uniform distribution, you say it doesn't really matter because you're very likely to land on a position that is completely irrelevant for your search. So it seems like highly inefficient.
No, but you sum, right? You'll do first global ranking. So suppose you want to find rank information about the sports, right? So you do the global ranking, and then you say you want ranking in tennis. So you just sample from this global ranking what corresponds to your tennis. But you see the still the global, you see what I mean? So it's okay to rank globally and then just take relevant entry. Yeah. They still will be ranked right in good good order, most likely.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Thanks.
Any other questions?
Thanks, Kostia, for this nice talk. So my question is, if I run push against Markov chain, what is the probability that I'll be able to, you know, write the poem that you show us? So you show us push against Markov chain.
Yeah.
And if I simulate that Markov chain, what is the probability that I'll be able to write a poem, you know, write the poem Eugene Onegi?
Well, it's minuscule, right? So it's not known in any probability textbook. I think it's computed. So what is the probability of a monkey to compose in some Shakespeare piece, right? So it's not zero, but
okay. Yeah. So can I ask one more question? Yeah. So my second question is about, again, related to the page rank algorithm. Yeah, so it was published probably around 1990 paper.
Yeah,
so but I heard that recently they have started using machine learning algorithms for ranking the pages. Do you know to what extent they are still using the page rank algorithm in their search? So are they still mainly relying on the page rank algorithm to rank the pages? Or are they
it's the same, you ask the same about the same question, right? As a gentleman asked, and so does Google still use PageRank?
I saw in the news that they said that they are using quite a bit of machine learning algorithms, but of course they keep it as a secret. So I'm just wondering whether
what I said, they use machine learning to tune the weights of the transition probability. This is what I know from our cases. But you know, even with respect to this, now there are so many applications of PageRank. So the applications in semantics, in semantic web, there are applications in the recommender system. Actually, with one of my current students, try to apply PageRank, and I think quite successfully in the recommender system. And the application in bibliometrics also in clustering. So in clustering, there's a nice application. What you do, you first run your data point by standard page rank. And you take, if you want K cluster, you take top K nodes or corresponding to the largest value of page rank. So this will be centroids of your clusters. And what you do personalized page rank with respect to these centroids. So now you don't restart from the uniform distribution, but you restart from the distribution concentrated on this centroid, right? So in this case, you estimate the probability. What is the probability, right, to on this, in some sense, biased random walk, biased towards this topic.
Yeah, thank you.
Any more questions? OK. Okay.
And of course, I'm here for two more days. So if you want to discuss something with me, just come and see me in person.
Are there any questions on yes, chat?
Maybe not.
Also, I have a question. We have some refreshments after this lecture. Does anybody know where it takes place? Is that at the school in the? Or would it be just outside?
Yes. There is one nice question from the audience. Could you explain how reinforcement learning works if the state space is very large? That's a very good question. And there's actually a good answer to this question. So a good answer to use some approximator for the Q value tables. And this approximator could be a deep neural network. So instead of trying to find the value of Q values, you try to find the weights of neural network which approximate best Q values. That's probably the best solution currently available for this question.
Okay, I think we should thank the speaker again and move on to the refreshments.